All right. Hi, my name is Dr. Randy Price, and I work for the LSU Ag Center. We've had a lot of interest around Louisiana this year about some of the sprayer drones and the agricultural drones that people are starting to see that are available, you know, through some different companies and the internet. And we have one here that we're going to demonstrate for you here in a minute. I'll go ahead and talk a little bit about some of the components of the sprayer drone, because you may be interested if you do buy one, and what you should look for and what you should get. We'll talk a little bit about what we've been seeing in some of the research we've been doing, you know, the document kind of like their spray characteristics and how well they, you know, maybe how even they are and things like that. And then in the end, we'll cover a little bit about the rules, because there is quite extensive regulation on flying one of these right now. So first off, you can go out and buy a sprayer drone right now, and it's going to be in a small package, one that you can fold up, put in the back of your truck or in the seat of your truck if it's small enough. They are getting quite large right now. There are ones up to size, like DJI makes a T30, which is a 30 liter carrying capacity. There's T16s, T20s, things like that. 30 liters is almost 7 to 8 gallons. So they are getting quite large. And I know the sugarcane farmers got real interested when they got like the T16 and the T20, because these are now have the characteristics that they could probably cover 15, 20 acres a day and do like, you know, palato or ripener spraying with that drone. So there's a lot of interest in that. We found that they are quite small right now for a lot of farmers. They're not gonna do 300 acres, but they may be useful for you for doing areas where a spray plane can't get into, like that is surrounded by trees, or hitting areas that maybe are too wet to run your spray truck. So there is a little spot there where these sprayer drones right now are gonna fit in really good. You may wanna spray fence rows, some areas where levees where you can't maybe drive on it or get on it, things like that. So we'll talk a little bit about the spray characteristics, because that's one thing we've been measuring. If you do spray a road or a levee, do remember there is still drift with these devices, okay? And that's one thing we've been seeing. A lot of them have a flow control, and if you fly it faster, the flow control will try to maintain the gallons per acre that you spray. Now, I should mention that these don't spray high gallons per acre. All of them spray 2 gallons per acre or less unless you travel really slow, but they're really meant for 2 gallons per acre or less. So there may be a little bit of a challenge. Some chemicals aren't rated for that low a spray application, so you need to check on that. But let's say you're gonna spray 2 gallons per acre. One thing you gotta watch is a lot of them want you to go fast, speed up the drone to get the efficiency, because the efficiency is based on how many acres or ground area can I cover per battery before I have to switch it out. Well, it turns out most of the energy is used holding all the weight up, the weight of the water, because these things are quite heavy. You know, they can be a drone that's anywhere from 35 to about 100 pounds. So that's one of the problems, is you want to fly it fast. Well, when you fly it fast and you have a rate controller, you guys know what happens. It has to increase the pressure through the orifice in order to maintain that flow rate, because you're covering more acre or more area with speed. So because of that, the pressure can get quite high, and we found that you can start producing a lot of fines if you're not careful. And these are just like any other aerial applicator. When you start producing fines, if there's a side wind or a crosswind, they will blow to the side. Okay, so people have thought, well, these, I should be able to fly like a levee or a fence row and not hit the crop next to it. Do keep in mind that 20 or 30 feet in, if you fly in the wrong conditions or fly it too fast, you may get some drift with these. And so you want to watch out with these if you're flying them. Try to keep the speeds down like any other spray device. If you can, medium speeds help. We do recommend that, we've been doing a lot of testing with different nozzles. They usually don't come out with AI nozzles right now, air induction, but we do find that the air induction nozzles you can put on here, they have regular nozzle fittings like any other spray truck or, you know, spray rig. You can change those out from the flap fans, which are usually just standard regular flap fans, and those AI nozzles will clean up the droplets a lot. They will reduce your drift by about 50% doing that. So that's one thing you can do, and you should keep in mind to do that. So the other thing is, we want to talk a little bit about the regulations on these. There is quite extensive regulation in the US for these right now. There are drones like anywhere from spray drones. We have a little miniature one that weighs like 10 or 15 pounds, all the way up to ones that are T30. We don't have the T30 yet, but that drone is approximately about 100 pounds when it's full. Currently, the FAA really only has drone rules. They call it the small drone UAS drone rules, because it's supposed to be vehicles under 55 pounds or less. So you really have to keep your vehicle under 55 pounds if you want to fly it under Part 107. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit about the 55 pound brake. So let's say you have a sprayer drone, you're going to always keep it under 55 pounds, or it weighs under 55 pounds with whatever load you put on it, and now I want to spray chemicals. Well, with the Part 107, you can't spray chemicals. It has a specific rule in there that says no hazardous chemical spraying. So in order to get the licensing to spray chemicals with your drone, you then need to get the Part 137, which is just a general dispensing of hazardous chemical type. It's not even really licensed. It's just a piece of paper that you submit to the FAA, and they send it back just like you have a spray business. The other thing you have to do is you have to do a flight test with the FAA. They want to make sure you know how to spray your drone and that the drone is capable of being flown safely. Usually that's pretty easy. You just go to Baton Rouge or somewhere where the FAA office is and a little flight test somewhere around that area, and you're done. Most of these drones are easy to fly. I will say that. We have small drones like the Mavic Mini, which fit in the palm of your hand. We have bigger drones, and we have these sprayer drones. These sprayer drones and the smaller drones fly exactly the same. There is no difference. They're that easy to fly. So flying it won't be the problem. Getting the licensing will be the hard part. If you do get the licensing for under 55 pounds, there's one other stipulation, and this is where things really aren't hashed out real well yet with the FAA, and they're working on that. They'll get it better as time goes on. Most of the Part 137 has places in there where it talks about it was really meant for agricultural aircraft with manned aircraft. So they have places in there where they talk about seat belts and things that you have to have inside the vehicle. Obviously, these small drones aren't going to carry a person, so there are no seat belts. So in order for the FAA to do this legally and keep things, you know, keep their I's dotted and their T's crossed, you have to get some exemptions for your drone not having a seat belt. So that's the fourth thing you have to do. When you complete all those, then you're good to go out and spray and use a drone. So I will talk about if you do decide to go over 55 pounds, and this is where the FAA will probably work on rules as time goes on, you fall into a different category. You're no longer in the small UAS category. Now you're under a large experimental drone. So you start having to get experimental licenses. So there's all different kinds of rules out there. So make sure you check with that, because that changes the whole dynamics. To give you some ways people are flying these, there are people who are using one drone just to treat certain areas. There are people who are doing roadway stuff. There are people who say, well, I'm going to fly my drone under 55 pounds, but I'll have four or five of them. And we'll cover a lot of area doing that. And that's called drone swarming. And there are systems that can do that. The FAA is trying to look at that and determine like how many drones can one person actually watch over and maintain without losing control. You know, the military's come up with things like three, and we'll see what the FAA comes with. But that's another way you can fly these under 55 pounds and cover more acre. So there's a lot of different rules to think about before you fly one of these. Okay, so this is a typical drone that you will see, one of the newer ones. This one has a pop-out tank. This year, a lot of these have these. This is really nice because, you know, this one may only cover like a third of an acre per battery per tank. So if you get three or four tanks, you can swap them out really quick. You're going to need multiple batteries, at least three or four to start with, probably 10 batteries if you're going to try and fly these continuously. Now, I should say one thing about the cost of the battery. The drone may cost you $15,000 to $25,000, right? The batteries are going to be about $1,000 each. So you may have an extra $5,000 to $10,000 just in batteries. That's just kind of the way it is, but you'll need those. Usually you're then going to need a rapid charger, because if you're going to fly multiple acres, you're going to have to keep this thing going. You're going to have to be landing it, changing things out, recharging batteries, and putting it back up in the air. So that's kind of how it works. You'll probably need a generator or something, and maybe a trailer out in the field. I will mention one thing that we found out. Don't stand behind these when you're spraying, because they will coat you with spray when they take off. So make sure that if you do spray one of these and you're outside, that you stay upwind or sidewind to the drone. Okay, so a lot of these do come in a package right now. They're small enough that they want you to be able to carry it in a vehicle without much work. This one we can actually get in front of a vehicle, which is good for us for research. So usually you're going to have to put the propellers out. They usually have carbon fiber, which you have to tighten up. I will mention the carbon fiber props and frames are really good. We've had a couple that we have, you know, have minor crashes, you know, as we were adjusting the flight controllers and things. And this stuff is rugged, which is really nice. You don't really break much if you do crash it. So So do realize this, they're pretty well built. Now, we have talked about corrosive problems with carbon fiber. No one kind of really knows the problems we're going to have with that yet, but that may be something to think about. If you want to talk about reliability, I do still tend to think, you know, these aren't going to be as reliable as your metal spray truck, which probably has at least a 10 to 15 year life. I tend to think a drone has about a 2 to 3 year life. So keep that in mind, depending on how much you fly it. Okay, I want to talk about the nozzles just a little bit. If you look at this drone, and this is very common, when people built drones, they said, how are we going to put a spray boom on here? Well, some do have extra spray booms, like your spray truck. But a lot of people said, well, I've already got arms sticking out, so just let me stick the nozzles underneath the motors. So about half your drones that are out there, you will see that they have a nozzle and an arm sticking off from underneath the motor. Now, this has good and bad qualities, okay? So if you're trying to get some insecticide down in like the soybean canopy, this may do that very well, because as you spray down, you've got a lot of air going straight down with it. So it's like pushing all those insecticides down in your canopy. In fact, when we fly these, we've noticed it blows down straight like an umbrella. And when it hits the ground, it mushrooms out because there's so much wind velocity coming down. So now keep that in mind. That's under no wind conditions. When this thing's floating over the crop, we have noticed there is some problems with flying these into the wind and with the wind. And that problem is when you fly into the wind, the drone actually has to fight it. It's got to tilt forward. It tends to blow everything back, okay? So when you turn around and you come back with the wind, it's then just floating with the wind. And that time it's pushing everything down. So we have noticed some inconsistencies in the patterns, and this is where people have had problems before, is getting a nice uniform coverage. It can be hard to do with the drone at times. We do kind of recommend right now, and we're still learning about these, that you try to fly a crosswind if you can. That way everything blows to the side, the drone is in the same orientation going back and forth, and it tends to have a more consistent pattern. So, or no wind conditions. Low wind, no wind conditions, then you really get a nice pattern, or can get a nice pattern. Okay, certain things you want to look for. These have industrial flight controllers, which are very good. In the old days, like we had to redo the compasses a lot, where you had to actually pick the vehicle up, turn it around, spin it on the axis. Obviously, as these get bigger, like the 100-pound ones, it's going to be hard to do that. So they've done a lot of work to get industrial controllers. The controllers work great. They have AB lines, things like that, where you can go out in a field and set an A line, fly to the under end of the field, set a B mark, set your swath width, hit go, tell it which direction you want to go, left or right, and it will work its way back and forth across the field just like a typewriter. Even to the point that they have some with liquid level monitoring. So when that liquid gets low, it'll actually stop, come back and land. You switch out the tank, the battery, whatever you want. Go back, hit return the path. It will go to the place where it left off and start spraying again. So pretty nice. So I will comment a little bit on some things you do need. Most of the commercial ones you buy will have this because these are necessities. It's nice to have a camera, because if you do an AB line, you may want to fly to the end of the back of the field. You're not really standing back there. So you can use the camera to get right to the edge, which will help you out and also monitor what's going on. There's usually a radar under here that's microwave. Lasers don't work very good because they tend to see through the crops. You can have sugar cane where there's a hole and a laser will see that and it'll dip down. So most of these have microwave radar, either down-looking or forward-looking. The forward-looking ones are for obstacle avoidance, like trees, things like that. The down-looking are for height control. The microwave's real nice because it sees real wide, usually like a 5 to 10 foot area, and it averages that all together. So they work really good over crops. So do note, some drones will come with obstacle avoidance, some will only come with height control. So you need to look at what you plan on doing. If you're gonna have trees and things you need to go around, you need to make sure there's obstacle avoidance. If you got a flat field all the time and there's no obstacles, you can just have the down radar. All right, I'd also like to give thanks to the people who helped fund us for some of this research so that we can build this and do some research. The Small Grain and Soybean Commission always board always helps us get a little bit of money to do this research, and the American Sugar Cane League. This year they've also given us a little bit of money to try and help develop these for sugar cane use. So thank all our sponsors. If anybody has any questions about this technology, you can reach me at Randy Price at the LSU Ag Center. You can look up my email and my phone number, and or you can contact your county agent, which I'll have a lot of information on this also.